Hi, I'm Lee from Educative. You're watching a segment from a special series of Educative Sessions with Fahim Ulhaq, the co-founder of Educative. In this episode, Fahim talks more about the role of mathematics in explaining the potential of a programmer and about his own struggles with the technical interview process. Enjoy the session. So, when it comes to all this higher level stuff that you, but you had to learn that when you were studying computer science in Pakistan. So what was your thinking as you were learning all of these things? Were you like disengaged with it, or did you just like treat it like any other requirement?
And first of all, that's not specific to Pakistan. Even if you're doing an undergraduate computer science program in US, you would definitely have to take those courses, at least many of them. I just kind of survived is how I would put it. And and earlier I said that the computer science degree doesn't necessarily need to be a four-year program, and you can achieve a lot in a two-year program. So if it was up to me, I would cut out a lot of those subjects. I would remove many of those advanced mathematics subjects that helps you a lot if you're solving a computer science problem. And in some small cases, it will help you write a program as well. But for the, I would say 95% of the programmer community, they don't really need it.
For you, however, so when it comes to these things that you think have diminishing returns, is there still some value to that? Or is that getting into a little bit deeper into computer science, data science, et cetera? First, I want to hear what you think is the actual core mathematics that people need to know to become a programmer that's worthy of you. And then think about, at least out of consideration of those who toiled away at learning those things anyway, how could they still be possibly valuable?
I think to be a good programmer, mostly you need middle school math, maybe some high school math. Obviously, you need to know, this is the number, this is the number system, and all of that. I'm not saying that the other more advanced subjects are totally unnecessary. What I'm saying is that a lot of people are scared because of those advanced subjects, and they think that if they can't pass those courses, or if they're not good at that level of mathematics, then they can't be a good programmer. And I think that notion is wrong. There's obviously, whatever you study, whatever branch of knowledge you take up, there's always some benefit. And in some way, you may find a way to apply that knowledge in your job. But for most practitioners, those topics have diminishing returns, as I said before.
All right. I hope that's not super controversial once these thoughts get out to the, but at the same time, I think you're making a strong enough case, and it's not, what you're saying is not heresy. I think I've heard this before of a lot of people who say, look, if you really want to do 95% of what most coders do, understand advanced algebra and understand, logic, because then logic will be very handy, conditionals, et cetera. All follow logic, right? Loops all follow logic. So I think that's a tough thing for people to wrap their mind around. Given how, at least in America, a lot of people follow a specific system of learning mathematics, right? For me, it was, I studied algebra eighth grade, and then geometry ninth grade, which has had no impact on my knowledge of code. Same with trigonometry, little to no knowledge there or application there. Pre-calculus and calculus, right? All of the above. It sounds, and now I realize they weren't training for computer scientists or even programmers. They're training for other forms of engineering or medicine, where they actually do use a lot of these things. My last question before we move on is, if you were to think of either the prerequisites or maybe courses that should be corollary to what people use, study when they become, in order to become a professional software developer, what would that be? Just minimal, at the bare minimum.
As you said, I would just say middle school math and some high school math, for example, algebra, and that's the extent of it. In a lot of cases,
sorry to interrupt, but what about statistics? What do you think? Do you think statistics is something that computer or programmers need, or is that perhaps a different branch?
It would help, like, to understand some stats and probability. In a lot of computer science problems, you have to leverage those two things. But I think, again, if you're not going to be a data scientist, you would like to use very basic stats. You would use averages and variances and standard deviations, and that's the end of it.
Right.
If you're taking classes or you're a machine learning engineer, then you would need some additional, like, you know, math and probability. Mm-hmm. For example, the conditional probabilities start becoming more important as you start working on machine learning. Mm-hmm. But for, like, non-machine learning programmers, there is, like, very little value in stats beyond the very basic standard deviations and medians and things like that. I'm not even recalling all of the basic stats functions. I'm struggling.
I think we're both, like, stressed out a bit because I'm reaching a lot for what mathematics I actually know how to articulate to you.
Yeah.
And you're bouncing back the same logic.
Yeah. All right. So I'm arguing that, you don't need a lot of math. And you're saying, well, then what math do you need? And now, like, you're thinking, what math? What are we talking about?
But right.
Before we move on, I would want to make one more point on this.
Fine.
In a lot of cases, people use math as a proxy for measuring the aptitude of a young person in programming. Mm-hmm. And as more and more schools are offering computer science courses, I think this will change over time as well, because instead of trying to use math as a proxy, now you would have real data. And the students themselves would also have real understanding that, yes, this subject is actually resonating with me. I actually love this. Before this, you were using math as a proxy, and you would say, well, you want to become a programmer. If you're good at math, then you're good at programming as well. And I think that's poor proxy, like many other proxies in the world.
Right. That's fair. Yeah. I guess it's one of those things that becomes so universal that it becomes a measurement for aptitude, but it doesn't necessarily directly translate. It's probably the closest thing of the core knowledges that does. Yeah. But I would dare say the language arts or learning languages in general, like, might be just as helpful. But now we're getting into the weeds, and I don't know if you want to really dive deep here, but why don't we move along and talk about something particularly fun for me, but very stressful for you. It's going to be, everybody has experienced some form of failure, but you actually were okay with talking about your interviews that you've been once rejected from. I'd like to start with the first technical interviews that you had when you were first coming from Pakistan to America interviewing for jobs. Please don't name the companies that you interviewed with, unless they're already public on your resume if you want to, but
yeah.
I'd love to hear more of at least what your experience is like. I think that's the most important thing.
So I only gave one technical interview for coming here to US. That was at Microsoft, and that's public because I worked at Microsoft after that.
Right.
So we can name the company as well.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think that one of the interviews that in which I didn't succeed was within Microsoft because I was trying to change a team. And funny enough, the feedback was that you're technically great, but you are, as if I remember correctly, you're too polite to work in this team. And that was my first introduction to, that was my first
introduction. What does that mean, right? What are they asking
for? To be honest, that's a euphemism for you don't have a backbone.
Oh.
Or you can't take decisions, something like this. Like, so that was just like in a nice way of putting this, that, in a lot of cases, you have to take decisions, and not everybody is going to agree with those decisions, because the line of the questioning in that behavioral interview, I didn't even know before that there are now behavioral interviews, but the line of questioning was around this is, okay, you have a problem and there are key stakeholders who who have a difference of opinion, and how, and you have to deliver something on time, how would you, like, you know, get to a resolution and deliver something? And I think the answer was that at some point I would say, well, this is the way, and this is because I'm the developer, I'm going to do it this way, and I feel very comfortable that we'll achieve the results that we wanted to achieve. But I think I never got to that point. I, like, you know, kept, like, finding ways to, like, you know, to get to a resolution, to get to a unified decision. Mm-hmm. And at that time, I didn't know about all of those, like, you know, like, I didn't about knew the Amazon leadership principle of disagree and commit, or things like that. So I just, mm-hmm. like, you know, tried, like, you know, kept going on and on about, like, oh, I'll, like, present them with more data. I'll present them with, you know, more facts. I'll run a, I'll write a prototype. All of the things where you're trying to get to a resolution, mm-hmm. where everybody agrees. And the reality is that in a lot of cases, you have to disagree and move forward. So that was, like, you know, one experience for me that was, like, you know, that was quite a learning experience, I would say.
Hi there. Hope you enjoyed this educative session. Be sure to check out more on YouTube or on any podcasting app. And be sure to like this episode, and don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Happy learning.